Welcome, a big hello to LifePoint Alliance Family Online. There are people that are coming in from all over the country. It's really neat. It's neat. Some of the families that used to be part of our church and moved away are now back part of our church. But anyway, welcome everyone to LifePoint Alliance Church, our church family. And Pastor Gary will open us in prayer this morning.
Well, good morning, everyone. It's good to see everyone's smiling faces as they come on. And even though I may not tell you personally, individually, we do think of you and pray for you. So good to see you and hear from you today. Let's all pray. Lord, as we gather once again for this 11 o'clock service, we gather, even though it's virtually, we still gather in your presence. And we gather together as a family that loves you, that worships you, that believes that you are our living Lord and our living Savior. And Father, as we gather together, may your blessings be poured out on each and every one of us. And may we receive those blessings with the joy, with the peace, with the grace that you intended, that as we share them with others, that you will be lifted up and we will be encouraged by your all that you have given us. And Lord, as we gather together as a family, our prayers, our singing, our worship to you, may they be a sweet sound, a sweet smell of worship and praise to you. So all that we do, all that we say, may it bring glory and honor to you, and may we all be encouraged by it. Bless this time together. Be with Pastor Joe as he leads the service, and all those who sing and pray, and we give it all to you, for it's out of our love for you that we come here this morning. And we ask this in the name of Jesus, I pray. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Thank you, Pastor Gary.
You only, you are good.
All right, everyone, if you got your Bibles, open to James. And I know some families jumped in since we've started the service. And again, I want to remind everyone, 4 o'clock this afternoon, come to the church for our parking lot service. And then starting next Sunday, 11 o'clock will be our parking lot service at the church each week. So if you're going to come online, you want to come at the 8 or the 9:30. And if drive to the church for the 11 o'clock service. Turn to James, the book of James, going to last sermon on the book of James. And I want to talk about the power of prayer. Throughout the book, James talks basically 7 times about prayer. And so I thought, good way to close the book out. I have no idea where we're going in the future. The Lord hasn't told me yet, but let's look at 7 reasons to pray. 7 facts about prayer. What is prayer? Well, I think we all know as believers, it's not only talking to the Lord, but it's allowing the Lord to talk to us as well. And the Lord will speak to us. I think his main way is speaking to us through his word, but he can speak to us by his spirit, by his still small voice. He can speak to us through other people. He can speak to us in dreams and visions. He has a lot of different ways that he can speak to us if we're in tune with him. But prayer is very special. Studies show that other people usually have a huge effect on our prayer lives. And so studies are showing that it's very important, for instance, if you have kids, that you teach your children at a young age to pray. And it's important that kids learn how to pray from both mom and dad. So not just at the dinner table, but at nighttime. And parents, it's important that you let your kids pray. Like you teach your children how to pray for their needs and school and for their brothers and sisters and the country. And so it's very important. If parents don't teach, then sometimes kids will pick it up from a godly Sunday school teacher who actually teaches the kids how to pray, or a youth leader. I know I learned when I got saved in college, the other college kids helped to teach me how to pray. So teaching children is important. This is a dad giving his daughter a driver's lesson. She just got her permit. They're in the parking lot. Her brother is in the back seat, and she's, you know, going crazy driving her first time out. And the brother in the back seat begins to pray, "Bless us, O Lord, for these thy gifts which we're about to receive from thy bounty through Christ our Lord. Amen." For food. And so the daughter says to her brother, I know you're scared, but why are you praying the prayer we pray at mealtime?" And the brother says, "Well, I am scared, and that's the only prayer I know." So listen, parents, make sure you teach your children other prayers than the prayer at dinner time, how to pray and talk to the Lord. I stole these from Pew Research. These are not very old. And these are some statistics about prayer. And I thought some of this stuff is interesting. So, for instance, those people who believe in God with absolute certainty, that's the first blue line. Or the second blue is they believe in God with fairly certainty. You'll notice that 97% of people who really believe in God pray every day. So people who believe in God, they pray. The people who don't believe in God very much, they do not pray, of course. And it's interesting how many pray every day. This next statistic, which probably shouldn't surprise us, is that when it comes to sex, whether men or women, 59% of women will pray every day as opposed to 41% of men praying every day. And I think everyone's, I don't know what it is, whether women just believe more in the power of prayer or they, I don't know what it is. Most prayer meetings always usually have more women than men. But even statistics tell us that women seem to pray to God more often than men do. This statistic kind of, it bothered me. I didn't like this. This is praying by your educational level. So you see in the United States that 43% of people who have graduated from high school pray every day. If you have some college, 32% pray every day. If you graduated college, now only 15% of the people in the United States that graduated from college pray every day. If you have a postgraduate degree, like a master's or a doctorate, only 9% of those people pray every day. And as I already told you, 93% of people who believe in God pray every single day. I know when I worked on my postgraduate degree that for me, the more I learned, the more I was like, there has to be a God. It just seems to me, but I don't know what the answer is to this. It's two things. Either one, colleges are very good at destroying the faith of people. So the more college you have, from going to college to graduating from college to going to postgraduate degrees, the more college you have, the more the faith is destroyed of the people who go. In college, there are a lot of very ungodly professors who I think their goal is to destroy any belief in God. And so these statistics would seem to back that up. A second thought I had is that in Corinthians, the Apostle Paul says that knowledge puffs up. So the more education you have, perhaps the smarter you think you are and the less you need God. You get puffed up in pride. And in self-sufficiency and this, brilliant mind, I guess, that you feel you have, and then you turn away from God and you don't pray to Him. It's very sad, but there are the studies and the statistics. And I thank the Lord that we have a lot of well-educated people in the church, in our church, who believe in the power of prayer. But let's come to James. And hold on. Come to James chapter 1, and let's look at the seven things that James mentions about prayer in his book. So the first one is verse 2, and that is to pray for wisdom to the Lord when you're going through life and you're hitting tough times, trials and tribulations. So James chapter 1, verse 2, consider it pure joy, my brothers and sisters, whenever you face trials of many kinds. So could be you lost a job, it could be the coronavirus, it could be whatever trial or tribulation you're going through. So whenever you face these trials, verse 3, because you know that the testing of your faith produces perseverance or patience. Let perseverance, patience, finish its work so that you may be mature and complete, not lacking anything. If any of you lacks wisdom, you should ask God, who gives generously to all without finding fault, and it will be given to you. But when you ask, you must believe and not doubt, because the one who doubts is like a wave of the sea blown and tossed by the wind. That person should not expect to receive anything from the Lord. Such a person is double-minded and unstable in all they do. So God says, I want you to come to me. I want you to pray for wisdom. I will give you lots of wisdom and discernment and tell you how to get through this and how you, maybe you can avoid it. But you need to pray in belief. If you have doubt that I exist, then I'm not going to answer. Hebrews 11:6 gives the same truth. Now, without faith, it is impossible to please God. For the one who draws near to him must believe that he exists and rewards those who seek him. So, hold on here. Let me move my... Second. James chapter 4. So we can come to God and pray for wisdom. Second, we can come to God and pray for the needs that are in our lives. So chapter 4, starting in verse 1, what causes fights and quarrels among you? Don't they come from your desires that battle within you? You desire, but do not have, so you kill. You covet, but you cannot get what you want, so you quarrel and fight. Now look at this. You do not have because you do not ask God. When you ask, you do not receive because you ask with wrong motives that you may spend what you get on your pleasures. F.B. Meyer writes, the greatest tragedy is not unanswered prayer, but unoffered prayer. So we all have needs, and we get frustrated when our needs aren't being met, and so we fight and we quarrel and we... You know, we get extreme. But God says, you don't have because you didn't ask me. I'd be happy to answer your prayers and the needs that you have. Although I'm not, if all of your needs are for money to spend on your pleasures, I'm not interested. In 1 Timothy chapter 6, God says he does give us lots of pleasures to believers for our enjoyment. But if the whole purpose of our life is to make life a 24/7 Disney world, look at verse 4. You adulterous people, don't you know that friendship with the world means enmity with God? So God's like, I will meet your needs. But don't be like totally selfish motivated for pleasures. Third, James encourages us to pray to seek God's will for our future. So let's look at James chapter 4, verse 13. Now listen, you who say, today or tomorrow we will go to this or that city, spend a year there, carry on business, and make money. Why, you do not even know what will happen tomorrow. What is your life? You are a mist that appears for a little while and then vanishes. Instead, you ought to say, if it's the Lord's will, we will live and do this or that. As it is, you boast in your arrogant schemes. All such boasting is evil. So I think it is very important that we pray for God's will for our lives, for the next year, for our future, for retirement, for a new job, for how to raise our family. Whatever those prayers are in the future, God is totally okay, and God often will reveal the plans that he has for us. We're to commit our ways to the Lord. But there's a catch, and the catch is that when you pray, you should have a sense of humility that we're just a vapor, and we actually don't know if we're going to live the next year. God may choose to take us home. In fact, the first three teachings on prayer that James says, there's a catch with each one of them. Prayer number one is, God says, pray for wisdom. The catch is, God says, I'll give you plenty of wisdom. The catch is, if you doubt, I'm not giving you anything. Number two, God says, pray for me for your needs, whatever your needs are. The catch is, but if you're always praying for more money so that you can be living in pleasure all the time, I'm not answering those prayers. Number three, God says, pray. Commit your future to me. Pray seeking my will for the future. The catch is, though, realize that life is fragile, you're a vapor, and at any time, I may call you home to heaven. Let's come to the fourth. James chapter 5, verse 12. This is a teaching, and it's a teaching that when you talk to others, don't misuse prayer by swearing and trying to get God involved in your conversation. This is a misuse of prayer. James chapter 5, verse 12. James starts out this verse by going, above all, my brothers and sisters. In other words, it's as if James is saying, this is one of the most important things I'm going to teach you so far in this letter. He gave his teaching in chapter 1, 2, 3, 4, and now suddenly near the end of chapter 5, James goes, hey, listen, above all, this is one of the most important things that I could teach you that you should listen to. Above all, my brothers and sisters, do not swear, not by heaven or by earth or by anything else. All you need to say is a simple yes or no. Otherwise, you will be condemned. We believe James must have heard Jesus teaching on this exact subject. In the book of Matthew, here's how Jesus taught on this subject. Jesus said in verse 33 of Matthew chapter 5, again, you have heard that it was said to the people long ago, do not break your oath, but fulfill to the Lord the vows you have made. But I tell you, do not swear an oath at all, either by heaven, for it is God's throne, or by the earth, for it is his footstool, or by Jerusalem, for it's the city of the great king. And do not swear by your head, for you cannot make even one hair white or black. All you need to say is simply yes or no. Anything beyond this comes from the evil one. That's exactly what James says here. That all you need to say is a simple yes or no, otherwise you'll be condemned. The Jews believed they were playing mental games. So they would say, I swear by heaven, and mentally they would go to themselves, well, I didn't really use God's name, and so I can cancel the oath in my brain, even though my mouth is saying something different. So I swear by heaven, I'm telling you the truth, that I'm going to pay you tomorrow. But since I really didn't use God's name, in my mind, I'm like, of course I'm not going to pay you tomorrow. I'm not going to pay you at all. And I would be okay. Or they would swear by earth. This is to me, this is like, I swear on my mother's grave. That's swearing by earth that I'm telling the truth. But in your mind, you're like, I didn't use God's name. Jesus says, forget that. Whatever you say in your mouth should be what you do. Let your yes be yes and your no, no. Anything else makes you a hypocrite. And if you start swearing, because as a Christian, you should be a person of integrity that tells the truth. If you start swearing, that comes from Satan. Satan added that in. So if you have to tell people, look, I'm really going to pay you. I swear on my life that I'm telling you the truth. If Satan just gave you that part of what you just said. And James says, you get condemned, you're going to have to answer. It's not that you're going to go to hell, but you're going to answer for listening to Satan and going into that swearing. So that's the fourth truth on prayer. The fifth, come to verse 13. Is anyone among you in trouble? Let them pray. Well, that goes back to the first, that if you're going through a difficult situation, a tribulation, a trial, trouble, pray to God for wisdom. He then goes on. Is anyone happy? Let them sing songs of praise. Praise is a form of prayer where you are just thanking God for what he has done in your life. And I think it's important that we not only pray when we're going through difficult times, but we pray with praise when we're happy and God's been answering our prayers. You see a picture here of a man breaking into a car with a coat hanger. There was an older woman that had locked her keys in the car. And she prays to God that, God, would you please help me unlock my car so I can get the keys that I left in the ignition. And while she's praying, she sees a coat hanger in the bush nearby. And she praises God. Thank you, God. You are such a good God. An amazing God that there's a coat hanger here. And so she takes a coat hanger and she tries to get in her car. She can't get into her car. And so she prays to God for someone to come along to help her get into the car. And sure enough, this guy comes along and she says, can you help break into the car? And she hands him the coat hanger. He opens the car in 5 seconds flat. She just praises God. Thank you, God, for sending this person. I just want to thank you. You're so good. And the guy said, this is amazing. I just got out of jail. I was in jail for 3 years for breaking into cars. And the woman looks at him and she wraps her arms around him in a hug. This is obviously pre-coronavirus days. And she says, praise you, God, you sent me a professional. That's how good you are. She's probably also checking to make sure he doesn't have a gun on him. So, you know, Jesus healed 10 lepers from one of the worst diseases you can have. And only one came back to give thanks. So I was thinking about if I had all the money in the world and my children come to me asking me for money, but they never give thanks. Like I'm always helping them out, always giving them money, getting them what they want, but they never come back. They're not grateful. They're not thankful. Then I can see why I would not. I'd be like, that's it. I'm not giving you anything more. You're just a bunch of ungrateful people. And I think we need to be careful that we're not that way with God. That we only come to God with our prayer needs, with what we want, and never to Him with praise. Psalm 92, 1-5 says this. It is good to praise the Lord and make music to your name, O Most High. To proclaim your love in the morning and your faithfulness at night. To the music of the 10-stringed lyre and the melody of the harp. For you make me glad by your deeds, O Lord. I sing for joy at the works of your hands. How great are your works, O Lord. How profound your thoughts. And study after study has linked gratitude to happiness. The more grateful you are, the happier you are. The more optimistic, the more hopeful, the more positive. And so when things are going well, praise the Lord. Number 6, praying to the Lord when we need healing. Verse 14, is anyone among you sick? Let them call the elders of the church to pray over them and anoint them with oil in the name of the Lord, the oil representing the Spirit of God. And the prayer offered in faith will make the sick person well. The Lord will raise them up. If they have sinned, they will be forgiven. Therefore, confess your sins to each other and pray for each other so that you may be healed. The prayer of a righteous person is powerful and effective. So, we're all righteous in Jesus Christ, but this is talking about the prayer of a person who walks with God, who is trying to do their best to live a holy life, that the prayers of saints are powerful and effective. Elijah, verse 17, Elijah was a human being, even as we are. He prayed earnestly that it would not rain, and it did not rain on the land for 3.5 years. Again, he prayed, and the heavens gave rain, and the earth produced its crop. So there's power in the prayer of saints. King James Bible, I want to bring out a word. It's called fervent. King James Bible, verse 16, confess your faults one to another and pray for one another that you may be healed. The effectual, fervent prayers of a righteous man availeth much. Fervent means like you really, you believe in the power of prayer, you believe in God, and you pray through until God answers. Elijah, in the American Standard Version, verse 17, Elijah was a man of like passions with us, and he prayed fervently that it might not rain. And it rained not on the earth for 3 years and 6 months. So I like that. Do we fervently pray to God? That we just keep praying until the Lord answers. Now, I believe when it comes to healing, that God can answer in many ways. God can answer miraculously, or God can use the instrumentation of many other ways to bring healing to our body, whether through doctors or dentists or psychiatrists or counselors. I think the important thing in Scripture is to bring it to God, though, in prayer and ask for the elders to anoint and pray. At the service this afternoon, the elders are going to be with their wives. Some of the elders, the wives, so if you need prayer for something, and I do, I feel frustrated in 2 months we haven't been able to anoint anyone. So you're going to just raise your hand out of your car. The elder and his wife will come. The wife will sanitize her husband's hands. He will wash his hands right in front of your windshield with, 70% alcohol. He then will anoint the back of your hand that you're sticking out your window. He will anoint it with the cross. Then I will pray for everyone that's anointed. And every person that he anoints, he will get his hands washed in between. So you should not fear getting anything. Look, God can heal in many different ways. Like when you go to a dentist, if you have a cavity in your tooth, I know God can miraculously heal that cavity. But I also know that God sometimes decides to use a dentist to fill that cavity. I know if you have problems with your eyes, that God can miraculously heal your eyes. Or God may use an optometrist. Or he might use someone that does LASIK surgery. I know that God can heal your hearing. And sometimes God will use a doctor to help you get hearing aids. And so but we're trusting the Lord. He has hundreds of ways he can heal, through medicine, doctors, whatever. But I think God wants us to bring it to him. I have I thought this was humorous, and so I'm throwing it in. A mechanic was removing the cylinder heads of a motor when he spotted a world-famous heart surgeon in his shop. "Doctor, please come over here." He did. The mechanic pointed at his work. "See here, doctor, I also open hearts, take out valves, put in new parts, and when I finish, this patient, the car, will run like new. So why do you get paid the big money for basically doing the same thing?" The doctor smiled, leaned over, and whispered to the mechanic, "Try doing it with the engine running." I thought that was humorous, and just praise the Lord for the blessings that God gives to men and women to help us. But let's bring it to the Lord in prayer. The seventh and the last one, praying for a lost soul or a backslidden believer. The last two verses of James, these verses are very controversial. Theologians have been fighting over these verses, and you'll see in a moment these verses are basically repeated in 1 John. So I'm going to give you my shot, but just we'll have disagreements, we'll fight, and when we get to heaven, we'll ask Jesus. Verse 19, "My brothers and sisters, if one of you should wander from the truth," so this is a believer. Lisa looks like a believer because they're called a brother and sister that wanders from the truth and someone should bring that person back so they come back to walking close with Jesus from being backslidden. Remember this, whoever turns a sinner from the error of their way will save them from death and cover over a multitude of sins. So this could apply to a backslidden person or to someone who's lost, that anyone who comes to Jesus, whether it's a backslidden person, there's a fresh forgiveness of their backsliding, their sin, or a new person just coming to Jesus, they get to experience the forgiveness of their sins. 1 John chapter 5, 16 and 17, we believe that James and John had to be talking to each other because they both end their books with a similar type of language. But this is how the Apostle John writes it, and I want you to see a couple of things here. So John says, if you see any brother or sister commit a sin that does not lead to death, okay, doesn't lead to hell, you should pray and God will give them life. He'll draw that backslidden Christian back to themselves. I refer to those whose sin does not lead to death. There is a sin that leads to death. I am not saying that you should pray about that. All wrongdoing is sin. And there is sin that does not lead to death. So listen very carefully. Christians, we sin. If anyone says they do not sin, they deceive themselves and make God out to be a liar. But when we sin, it doesn't lead us to hell, okay? But there is a sin, if you look at the middle there, there is a sin that leads to death, that leads to hell. I'm not saying you should pray about that. Now, what I think that is if someone blasphemes the Holy Spirit, that is a sin that leads people to hell. And John, he was there when Jesus gave that teaching, that if anyone blasphemes the Holy Spirit, there is no forgiveness either in this lifetime or the next lifetime. It's an unforgivable sin. So John is saying, if someone would backslide, if someone actually commits this sin, don't pray about it. Don't pray. Because they can't be forgiven, either now or in the future. So let me stop here for a moment. This is a whole sermon in itself on the sin of the blaspheming of the Holy Spirit. I do want to say this. Often Christians worry, have I committed this sin? Have I done this? If you had committed this sin, you would not be online right now. You would not be praying to Jesus. You would not be reading the Bible. You would not be sharing his name. You would not believe in the power of prayer. You would have nothing to do with God if you committed this sin. So do not worry, you have not committed this sin. Here's the point I want to get to, though. So if you see a brother or sister who has backslidden, it says you should pray and God will bring them back. It's the power of prayer. And that's the truth in James. So I think there's incredible power in prayer, not only to pray for backslidden people to come back to Jesus, but to pray for the lost. Pray. Pray for your loved ones. Pray for your neighbors. Pray fervently. Do not give up. Pray for them to come to Jesus, and you will see the power of prayer and what God can do, the miracles that he will do in his life to try to win that person to himself. Well, I have to close. I didn't have time for this, but there's the seven truths on prayer from the book of James. Pray for wisdom. Do not doubt. Pray for your needs, but not if they're selfish for your pleasures. Pray for God's will for your future, but realize God may call you home to heaven. When you pray, don't drag the Lord's name in swearing that you're telling the truth. Let your yes be yes and your no, no. When you're praying, praise the Lord when he's answering your prayers and meeting your needs. Pray when you're sick. Commit your illness to, you know, bring it to the Lord. Have the elders pray for you and anoint you with oil. And trust God to move in many ways to touch your life. Pray for the backslidden and for the lost. And you will see God do amazing things. I know I have in my life. We're going to close. Let me pray for everyone. Father, I just thank you for my brothers and sisters. And I know, Lord, I'm preaching to the choir. I pray that everyone's prayer life would be amazing, that we would find some time every day to get in our prayer closets to pray and to praise you. And Lord, you've even taught that it's not a matter of how much time or how many words. The pagans pray and use many words, that we are not to be like them. That, Lord, we could just have this wonderful conversation with our Heavenly Father. Jesus, we thank you for the power of prayer. To the Father, in the name of Jesus, through the guidance and the leading and the power of the Holy Spirit. Father, may we be powerful prayer warriors for you. May we be fervent in our prayer life. And we give you praise and thanks. In your name we pray. Amen. I'm going to unmute everyone so you can say goodbye until you say hello at 4 o'clock later on today. So let me unmute everyone. Okay, you are all unmuted. Thank you, Dana, for doing a great job with worship. Oh, someone sounds like they're getting out of their car already.
Yeah.
They're already at the parking lot. So.
Hi, everyone.
Great. Hi. Ken.
Hi.
I see.
Hi, Robin.
Hi.
Bye.
Bye.
Ken, I think you should sing sometime at a worship service.
So. Thanks. Sharon. Lego.
I can't see everyone at the same time.
So. Oh, yeah. Keep moving around. Over
yeah.
And over.
Come on.
Yep. Love all you guys.
Bye.
I hope.